I beg your pardon, ladies and gentlemen. I did not know that you were waiting for me. You see, I'm all dressed up because at any time that you look at the show, I want to receive you properly, you see, because it's very important, the presentation. This is Les Halles. That's where all the town comes for marketing, you see. And what is nice in Les Halles, it's when it's about empty, as it is now, you know, there is always a flower vendor to leave you a little buttonhole. You know? That's the gentleness of the people of the street. Now, ladies and gentlemen, you're going to see and hear a fairy story. Yes? The legend of the enchanted banquet. A banquet is a long sofa, you see? A banquet that the owner of this little cafe behind has been dreaming to have all his life. A beautiful red plush banquet, you see, like the ones at Maxime, you see? But the drama is that when they bring that banquet, that sofa, it's too long. It's too long for the little cafe, and that is very sad. But that banquet will allow you to meet a very, very attractive girl who, like every other girl, lacks diamonds, you see? But she doesn't like diamonds to wear. No, no, she likes diamonds to eat. Yeah, you have already seen a woman eating diamonds? Oh, it's cute. It's cute. It's a bit expensive, but it's very cute. And after that, you will see that that girl is also a gang leader. Oh, but don't be upset because I told you it's a fairy story. So now, as every fairy story, it starts once upon a time.
Toutes écrabouillées. Si je vendais des crevettes, au contraire, elles frétiraient.
Faut choisir sa marchandise, connaître le goût du client. Faut choisir sa marchandise et marcher.
Mes esquimaux ont fondu, l'autre avec ses cacahuètes, les grillettes en soufflant dessus.
Faut choisir sa marchandise, connaître le goût du client. Faut choisir sa marchandise et marcher.
Thank you.
Thank you.
If for a moment I look like a ghost, it is to help you move out of this century and back to the Paris of 1640. Time to invite you, Rue Mauconseil, among the aristocrats, the beauties, and the hoi polloi in a theater at the Hôtel de Bourgogne. You will be in the front boxes with Roxane, among the eyes with her admirer, Christian de Neuvillette, and all over the theater with Cyrano de Bergerac. Cyrano in action. Philosopher, poet, maker of rhymes and of duels. A man of wit and of spirit. Far too independent a spirit for the liking of his enemies, who have reason to fear his pen as much as the point of his sword. But a man who needs to look no further than the end of his nose to know that he is ugly. Cyrano's tragedy begins with this letter from Roxane, his beautiful cousin Roxane, whom he loves in silence. This letter seems to be an invitation to a first rendezvous. But this and similar mistakes in correspondence are eventually going to ruin his whole life. Thank you. writer for the public, Cyrano now becomes a private secretary. For love of Roxane, he agrees to ghostwrite his rival's letters to her. Under a balcony, his are Christian's words that burn the night with sounds of love. At dawn, on the day of battle, Cyrano is writing yet another letter that he will sign with Christian's name. Although Christian doesn't know of this as yet. Cyrano writes a love letter, sometimes two each morning. You think that's a lot, but Cyrano loves enough for two or more. Even though he lacks the power to express himself, Christian does not lack heart. When he learns of Cyrano's sacrifice, he replies with the sacrifice of his own. Christian has been dead for 15 years. Those 15 years, Roxanne has spent in retreat, remembering him. Her love for Christian, born of the letters signed with his name, is her only memory. But her only distraction is Cyrano's weekly visit to her. For 15 years, every Saturday. Cyrano's enemies have not forgotten his scorn of them, his satires and his sarcasms. Neither forgotten nor forgiven. Visit to Roxanne, and she will learn too late that she had but one love and lost it twice. thought I should be the price of that dress. I know that the ladies will be very discreet about it. No, I want to address the gentlemen in the audience to give them a warning. It will always come a time when you walk on the Grand Boulevard in Paris or in the Champs-Élysées with a beautiful lady on your arm. Maybe that beautiful lady is your wife. That's fine. Maybe she's not your wife, but that's not my business, you know. No, I want to give you the warning, gentlemen, that when that beautiful woman stops suddenly and sets her eyes on a dress like this, a black dress, especially a black dress, buy it, gentlemen. Buy it without even asking for the price, because first, black is a very becoming color, and secondly, because when a woman sets her mind on acquiring a dress like this, she will stop at nothing. At nothing! So, buy it, because after all, the price of that dress will be cheaper than, excuse me, a funeral. You think I'm kidding? No, I'm serious. Look at that man in the fiacre. That man could be you. Sevilla. In what year? 1830. Or whenever you like. The story? It is the story of a man, Don José, who is destroyed by passion. And of a woman, Carmen, who destroys through passion. Carmen is timeless. In a Spain given over to love, of love, or to love of death. José has been looking for Carmen. He finds her at the end of the night, at Lila's Pastia. This inn is the meeting place for all the gypsies, the thieves, and smugglers and murderers. The night of love passes into morning, continues into the afternoon, but its pleasure are quickly forgotten by Carmen. The only pleasure she has left to ask of her lover is the loss of his own soul. She provokes him to prove his manhood by joining the bandits who are waiting for them in the street below. But Don José has still the strength to resist.
Thank you.
Carmen has proved her power over men. Don José has proved to her that he is a man. Proved it by killing another man. Carmen has nothing more to ask. Don José, nothing more to give. She can desert him, leave him to his damnation.